Today I talked to a man named Kamarul. Kamarul Muhamed, to be precise. He's a man who started a drone company called Aerodyne that is in 6 short years, entered 35 markets, and is currently ranked number 2 in the world today. He's a fascinating guy, this fellow Kamarul, not just because he's a traveler, photographer, a plane and drone pilot himself, but also because he's someone who's fascinated by human history, astronomy, theoretical physics, and of course technology. He's a man who also hails from Kelantan, and where by his own admission, it's a state where the women work harder than men. And it's a state that is filled with entrepreneurs, which partly explains why he is the way he is. And so over the course of an hour, we talked about all kinds of things. Business, of course, life principles, business principles, yes. But also we talked about astronomy, black holes, robots and UFOs. And of course, IPOs, because within a few short years, he will be becoming a public company. I hope you'll enjoy our chat. He's a good guy and a real asset to Malaysia. And if you enjoyed our podcast as much as I did recording it, please do like, share and subscribe. In the meantime, stay safe and take good care of yourself. In Jake Kamarul Muhammad, Aerodyne, it's a great pleasure, a great honor to be talking to you. I've been reading about you for a long time and finally we are doing this after having met virtually on one of the business conferences. So let's start at the start, right? And I want to get from you, who is Kamarul? Where does he come from? What's his hometown? You know, what did your parents do? What were your influences when you were growing up?
Well, I'm from Kelantan. You know, Kelantanese have entrepreneurial blood in them. You know, my late dad, he just passed away just a month ago. My late dad is also an entrepreneur. Before that, he was in serving the nation, serving the country. He was in the military. My mom is forever an entrepreneur. She's still an entrepreneur at her current age as well. You know, just like any Kelantanese blood. Right. So my younger days, I was at MRSM. I was in MRSM Kota Baru. Then I went to the UK. I spent 10 years in the UK. And I came back. I joined Computer Associates. And after a couple of years, I couldn't hold it. Again, I just need to do things my way, basically. So I quit the corporate life. But in the beginning, I was doing something else. I was doing, at that time, I was really unsure what I wanted to do. So it's more of pursuing what I like at then. You know, I'm a man with several histories, several past life, I would say. So when I was in the UK, I was an auditor. You know, I was an auditor, and then I was like, in my second year, I was already auditing a PLC over there. So it gave me great experience there. So I would say I have pretty good financial sense. You know? But by the time, after 4 years of doing it, I decided this is not for me. I'm a risk taker. You know, I like to innovate. I like to think of new things. You know, that profession, you cannot make something out of nothing, basically, right? Accounting and auditor, you know, is for you. It's about governance and all that. Right. So at that time, but then I realized that my interest lies in IT, right? So I did my master's in IT as well. So I came back, I joined CA. At that time, the world's second largest software company. So I liked it at that time. You know, I was doing consulting, basically, using our software. We worked with, even at that time, Kasim Chan. Kasim Chan is like AC.
Back in the days.
So we were doing consulting. Our clients are people like Petronas, Maybank and all that. So it was fun for a while because of my background. Oh, I forgot to mention, while I was in the UK, I did my pilot license too. I always have this fascination for flying. So I have my PPL then as well. So my passion has been flying. Finance, actually, I still enjoy the finance side. That's why this leads to us already completing multiple M&As. I like that part of finance, you know, evaluating company, doing the due diligence, you know, and then coming up with a value. That's interesting to me. I'm feeling very high every time I do that as well. So far we have completed about 7-8 M&As already, and we have 5 in the pipeline now. So that's the finance side of me. I have another fascination as well. I'm a creative person as well. So I have a creative platform for a couple of years. I was pursuing something that I like, which is photography. So that's the part where I've been traveling the world. I've been to more than 100 countries. I was at that time pursuing media work, basically. You know, I have my other business. The business is running. But I just love traveling. I mean, I get to go to the you know, the Swiss Alps, the French Alps. I went to all the way to Alaska. I went all the way to Greenland, then Africa. I spent a lot of time traveling. I spent 2 months in Russia, for example. So it's fascinating, you know. So basically, I was like pursuing what I like. So I have that, and that's actually how I started with drones. So I was carrying my drones as well, while doing this adventure, right? Then I became a pretty good, decent drone pilot as well. And that's really just doing it for fun. And I mean, I was feeling very happy. I mean, I was doing things that I liked at that time, photography, videography and all that. But then there come a stage in life, I said, oh, okay. The money was good, really. Money was good as well. But that part of the business is not something that I can scale. You know, if you are a dentist, right? I mean, you can't scale. You have to do your work yourself. I just like my business as well at that time. So hence, Aerodyne was born. It's really a paradigm shift, or rather a change of philosophy. If in the past we were in the pipeline business, which means that if I want water, I have to go in the bucket business, I have to go and get the water myself. So then it was a conscious decision. I want to go into building something new. And because of my experience in drone, I came to realize, and this is before it was even used for industrial applications. I mean, I came to realize, hey, and this is the IT side, my fascination in technology and all that. I came to realize that, hey, we can do a lot more things rather than taking photos and videos. So we were one of the global pioneers actually using drones for industrial use. So we actually developed new solutions to manage projects. So I was with the CEO of one of the largest property development in Malaysia at that time, you know, and he was telling me how information comes to me 2 months too late. You know, information are actually 2 months later. And as a result, decisions that are made are based from information that is 2 months ago, right? 2 months too late, basically, right? So what we did was, okay, I told him, Dato, why don't if I develop a system for you, I give you a dashboard, and I use our drone so that it gives you the visibility of what's happening outside. So we create a dashboard, we fit in the information so that basically your information, your decision-making will be based on real-time data, basically. So that's what we did, right? So I started with one site and it grew to two, it grew to four, eight. And within less than 2 years, we have like 50 sites around the country doing this kind of solutions, right? And some of the largest property projects in Malaysia, we were doing it, you know, including Rapid Project in Pengerang. That's actually a $40 billion project, for example, right? And we are the only people managing and reporting on the progress of that construction project, for example. So at some stage, I have more than 40 people full-time over there at Rapid as well. So that's how we started, really just doing that part. Then straight away, again, the drone industry started to started to mushroom around the world. You know, some people were doing something similar to us as well. And we decided that we need to have an edge. We need to be better than all of those guys, right? So then we started to go into data side. So then we say, hey, why don't we look at critical infrastructure? What's critical infrastructure? National grid, for example. We started with that in Malaysia. Now our solution for national grid monitoring is already being used in Japan, in Middle East, in America, in Canada, in Europe, in Latin America and all that. Starting here in Malaysia, even in Australia. We started here, then we went to Australia first, and we are now exporting this globally. So from that, now we have done wind, we have done solar, and so on and so forth. We do road, highway, bridges, you name it. So the idea here is that we provide, first of all, any solutions have to be solutions that make sense, solutions that make business sense. So what are they? Solutions that is faster, better, cheaper, and safer, right? Otherwise, there's no reason for them to change, right? People has been doing this for donkey years, right? The manual method. Some use helicopters, some use, your crane, you travel around, along the line and they do inspection, and it's an incredibly slow, dangerous, you know, and expensive process. So just like any digital transformation, you are looking at solutions that can disrupt the process. So we came up with a solution, hey, instead of you using your helicopters, use our drone. Instead of you use engineers to do this analysis, use our AI to do this analysis. Guess what happened? We are able to save them up to 20% of their costs. And not only that, we do our process four times faster as well. So that make perfect sense for the customers to use our solutions, isn't it? Right? But of course, it's not easy too, right? I mean, it doesn't mean that everybody. I mean, if you have something that is already working, there has to be a real compelling reason for people to change. Even when people in the beginning, when they see the value too, right? If there is no top-down push to adopt new technology, most organizations just, hey, let's just do business as usual. So we do a lot of engagement as well to let people understand the value of our solutions and all that. So yeah, so that's how we started. So we started in 2015, early 2015 and 2014. Today we are in 35 countries. We are 500 people. Now, the guys just asked for approval just now. They want to hire another 100 people next month, you know, as well. So it's an exciting time for us right now, actually.
It's crazy, man, Kamarul, because, you know, I look at you and you are as enthusiastic and as excited and as activated as a teenager, right? But you're not a teenager. I think you are right about my age or maybe younger. And it's unusual because the way you're talking to me now, you're so positive and energetic. When you talk, I'm smiling because I'm enjoying it as much as you do. I want to go back to your Kelantan days, because when you talk about Kelantan, right, Kelantan people have a reputation for being entrepreneurs, right? And I think I also heard that the women are more entrepreneurial than the men, apparently. I don't know whether that's true or not. So in your case, your mum, your dad, both of you, what is it about Kelantanese that are so entrepreneurial?
To be honest, I don't have an answer. I've been wondering the same. I think
is it the sea air or is it the makan or what?
I think probably is the DNA. You know, I think it's a cultural thing. It's been like that, like forever. You know, you know, my mom, all my aunties, my grandma also, everyone. And of course, some of the men would not like me saying this, but the men are lazier than the women in Kelantan.
That's what I heard. Is that true?
Yeah, because the women are the breadwinner. You know? But of course, in the past.
I heard that. Is that true?
At some stage, it was probably true as well. But Kelantanese in general are very entrepreneurial, right? I mean, they travel, they lead. I wouldn't say nomadic, but they like to travel, and then they are everywhere, you know. And then even when I was in the UK as well, I spent 10 years in the UK. Most of the Kelantanese folks are actually always doing trade in one form or another. There's this guy that. Would buy cars in the UK and then send back to Malaysia, become an agent. And there's so many. I mean, people like, I guess it's in the, you know, upbringing, you know, with the programming that we go through as a child, right? You know, yeah. I mean, we are formed during our first 7 years of life, right? So when you, yes. you're brought up in that environment, you see how, you know, everyone is taking risks, everyone is working, I would say, crazy, you know, crazy hours. But the satisfaction is there, right?
You know, the other day, right, Kamarul, I was listening to one of my old podcasts with a fellow Kelantanese, Dr. George Lee. He's a doctor, urologist. And he was saying that in Kota Baru, where he's from, the races all intermingle quite openly, and there's a lot of harmony there, which is, again, unusual because KL, you don't necessarily see that, right? And I want to go back again to your entrepreneurial background, because I don't want to generalize, but you know, when you read Tun Mahathir's book, The Malay Dilemma, from the early 70s, mid 70s, you know, the generalization is that the Chinese are entrepreneurial, the Indians will go to become doctors and lawyers, and then the Malays will be a little bit more, I guess, laid back, for want of a better word. But people like you and what you've done in Aerodyne is really quite contrarian, because the other thing that I read about you is that you did this your own way, right? Like Frank Sinatra, as you were saying, you funded this yourself, you got the deals yourself, and then I think your wife also helped you, and then you poured like $1 million of your own savings inside this thing. So explain that early journey, you know, 2014, not that long ago, it's only about 6-7 years ago, you know. And did you do it with government assistance? How much of the government policies were involved? Was NEP, you know, those kind of things, government loans, was that part of the equation?
Let me tell you a story on that. So basically, a short answer is no, right? We didn't get help from anybody. In fact, I have this clear, how do I put this? I'm trying to be polite here. I don't want to use hatred. I have clear discernment for grantrepreneur. All right, I have a lot of people that actually came to us in our early days. They say, hey, you guys are doing great stuff, you know. I can help you get grants, you know, I can help you grants, you know. So non-stop, I will get this almost like every month people will come to me. You know, to me, grants would be necessary, you know, to help companies grow and all that, right? But if there are a lot of grantrepreneurs in the past, I'm not sure about now, at least in my early days, people would just jump from grant to grant because that's easy money for them, right? I'm not sure about now because we are never in that ecosystem, so to speak. But there was a trend at that time, 2005, 2006. There are even people that say, hey, you should hire one person dedicated. His job should really just be about getting grants. And to me, hey, that's not the spirit of entrepreneur. Entrepreneur is about slogging away, about believing in your vision. Of course, you need capital. Of course, you need money. But if you have money, don't go and get money that otherwise can be used for others as well, right? So I was shutting it down. I mean, that was even, I would say, our internal belief. We wanted to show that, hey, you can build a company without getting grants. And till today, we have not gotten a single cent of grants from the government. But of course, the government helped us quite a bit as well. Now, not in the beginning.
So those early days, you just funded everything yourself, lah. It was like your own cash flow, your own savings, and your wife was involved as well, right? She was helping you, kind of like a husband-wife team also, right?
Yeah. So we dump in about $1 million of our savings, lah, or rather from our companies, lah, right? I mean, our previous business and all that we put in. And within a couple of months, we finished the $1 million already. So we were getting worried already. Right, but fortunately we scored some long-term deals at that time, and it quickly stabilized the cash flow again, and then we started to grow, and we were fine. I mean, it was all organic growth. It's only in by the time 2017 we started to go to Australia, so we started to spend our own internally generated fund to expand to the first country outside Malaysia. We went to Australia, then we started to feel the stress on our cash flow as well. Then we have another opportunity to open our operations in London. And then with that, another opportunity in the EU as well. I said, okay, maybe this is the time that we need to raise fund. So that was our Series A then. We closed our Series A in 2018, the first round. Right? We have been growing every single year. Some countries are doing better than the other. Then came the pandemic. You know, the pandemic put some countries in a very bad state, but there's some opportunities on the other side. So what we have done really is that we developed two engines of growth. While our business as usual, our BAU is actually slowed down a little bit. So we developed two new engines of growth, just like what Einstein said, with every crisis, there's opportunity, right? The Chinese also say the same thing, right? Crisis and weather is the same word, right? I mean, it's essentially the same thing. Yin and yang, right? So that's actually what we did, right? We are now 1.5 years now. We are close to 2 years now, right, Dori? No. 1 year lah. We are 1 year plus lah. We are 1 year into 1 year plus into the pandemic. And I think it's not ending anytime soon. Seriously, I don't think so.
Yeah. I don't think so. Yeah. Which is
so what
I
we
don't
did.
Think so. Which
yeah.
is
yeah. Which is why we're doing this virtually, because we would much rather do this in person. But you know, it's quite dangerous. I want to get more into you because you know when I read your blurb, right, Kamarul, you've got this passion in history, right? Astronomy, theoretical physics. These are geek stuff, like real, like deep geek stuff, right? Technology, right? How does this interest, and how deep is this interest, right? How deep does this interest shape how you form Aerodyne, how you talk to your people, how do you do you know your motivation, your management style? How does that inform all those things?
Definitely. This is me. I mean, I've been like this even at secondary school. I mean, I'm fascinated by the world. I try to understand how things work. You know, I'm fascinated with astronomy. And when astronomer managed to, for example, photograph a black hole for the first time in 2019, I was like, I mean, like, I'm so elated. I mean, it's like, wow, you know, a black hole was you know, Einstein, you know, talk about it, that black hole exists, but nobody can prove it. And here we are in 2019, you know, black hole was photographed for the first time. And just last month, we managed to photograph lights coming out from behind the black hole, something that Einstein even predicted is going to happen, predicted that it exists.
So what do you think this means? What does black holes mean for humankind and for the Earth? What does it signify?
Exactly. I mean, that's the question. I mean,
is it time travel? Is it intergalactic travel? What does it signify?
Well, you know, just like we orbit the sun, right? All the planets in the galaxy orbit a black hole. So black hole is the engine that drives all the solar system, all the planets and the stars around the black hole to actually rotate as well. I mean, some that doesn't have that, but generally that's the idea, right? So some believe that black holes are collapsed stars, right? Some believe that we are living in a multiverse. So that the black hole is the access to the other parallel universe as well. I mean, this is mind-blowing stuff to me.
So I'm trying to square this person, Kamarul, who is basically a dreamer and the entrepreneur businessman, right? Because when you really consider the infinite possibilities of the universe and the galaxies beyond, it makes what we do on Earth so minuscule and so meaningless, right? Because there's so many things bigger than us, right? How do you square that? And do you treat Aerodyne and business almost like a game? Do you gamify? Do you gamify what you do? And in so doing, have a result at the end of the day, and there's obviously monetary results, but how do you view the world of business as the person you are?
Before I go to that, I mean, you mentioned just now that how small we are and the galaxy, the universe and all that is so big, right? But guess what? We are all one and the same. We are part of the universe, right? We are all made of the same thing. We are all made of the same matter.
100% I agree with you, man.
We are made of the same matter that's scattered all around, even though this matter only accounts for about 5% only of the visible universe, right? So I do not we are minuscule. I do feel that we are big because we are part of the universe. We are one of the universe. We are part of the universe, right? And we all have our own purpose as well. My purpose as well is actually to do good to humanity, to mankind, and impart real change to humanity. I mean, that is actually our mission at Aerodyne, my personal vision too, you know. So to me, what drives me in doing what I do today is actually to create jobs, to help solve societal problems, to solve inequalities. Today, we live in a world that there's a lot of inequalities, right? People do all the dangerous jobs, you know, they put their lives at risk, and they earn a minuscule amount of money, right? So there's a lot of inequalities. A lot of people today became who they are because of where they are born or who they are born with. So to me, what if we can use technology? And then that's what I dream about. You know, what if we can use technology so that in the future, perhaps we can help solve these problems of equality? So that's actually what drives us in Aerodyne.
Okay, so with an Aerodyne, right? How have you built the company? You talked about how you're going to hire another 100 people and you've got, I don't know, 3,000 people now, right?
No, 500.
500, right? So, so you're going to increase headcount by 20%, just like that, right? Why do people join you? Do they join you for the... What constitutes the appeal behind working with you and working in Aerodyne?
You see, Chong, I mean, our philosophy is very clear for others to see as well. You know, what drives us, what's our passion, right? I talked to you earlier about, you know, our why is actually to make a real difference. Humanity sounds so big, but let's refocus into just Malaysia. Malaysia also, I mean, let's talk Malaysia. Malaysia, what's our issues? Unemployment. You know, what's our issues? Our global competitiveness. We are not really there yet, at least at the moment, you know, in terms of our technical capabilities. So a lot of the things that we are doing right now, we are proving to the world that we Malaysian, despite all of these challenges that we have, we can produce world-class technology. So we put our focus and energy into that. And in fact, it's one of our biggest challenges as well. So people who join us are people who have this long-term fascination, like what we have here as well. So what I've done in the beginning is that, and this is a difficult journey. I'm sure every entrepreneur will share the same thing, right? So first, you train yourself. I mean, you yourself must have that passion. You must have that clarity, that vision of what you wanted to achieve. But nobody can do this alone, right? You need to have a team, right? So first, and you can't build a team immediately. So what we did was, I built people around me that that believes in this vision that we have. So once we have this, we build a bigger community. You build a bigger multiple teams within the organization, and it's a trial and error process, right? There are those that doesn't fall into the vision that we wanted to achieve, or rather the way we wanted to do it. That's fine. We can part ways in a nice way, right? So it is the first I would say 3 years of the organization was about building this team. You know, so by the end of the third year, I was feeling very comfortable that I have a very strong team, people who believe in our cause, in our the French call it the raison d'être, the reason for being, why we are doing all of these things, right? So as a result, it's easy to function and work because we are on the same wavelength. You know, so our decisions are based on the same principle, our decisions are based on the same objectives, you know, at least at the management levels, right? At the senior management level.
What about a working level? What about a working level? Because you've got people like drone pilots, and that's a pretty scarce resource, right? They have to be trained, and there's very few of them already experienced out there because it's so new. And then you've got your AI people. AI is another very, very new area, right? And your analysts and things like that. And then you also have grown by acquisition. So there's going to be people from, I don't know, around the world, you know, France or Europe or, you know, North America that have joined your team. And they're very different culturally speaking as well, different backgrounds, different, you know, different race, different religion. So how do you make sure they all work well together?
That's the part that I talked about earlier. You have to build your core team. So we built this team first before we started to go out, right? Because this is important. I mean, this is like your generals, right? So when we go out, these are the guys that actually go out, and some of them are even stationed there, right? They understand our culture already. They understand our core values. They understand our technology, our solutions, and all that. These are the guys that enabling this to happen, basically. The strong team, the strong senior management team that I have, basically. You know, of course, there are cultural differences that we need to compromise. There are cultural, the different way of doing things, different philosophy that we need to adapt. And that this adaptation process that we went through actually improves the organization as a whole as well. Because even for Aerodyne, we cannot be thinking that we are a Malaysian company. So we made that decision in 2018 that we needed to be a world-class organization. In fact, we ran a process where we call WC19. We wanted to be a world-class company by 2019. So we started the process. I mean, basically, we put in the structure in place, what we needed to do. There's 4 pillars about this. One of it is that we must do things right, that we must be doing the right thing. You know, and then of course each of these have 14 items altogether that we needed to do in order to become world class. Right? Doing things right is the usual stuff: the quality, the on time, the delivery, the meeting budgets, and all that. That's a given. But doing the right thing is the tough part. Doing the right thing also involves having enough resources, making the right decisions.
What is doing the right thing? You know, what is defined as the right thing?
Doing the right thing is doing the thing that is aligned to our vision.
And what is that
vision?
And
also doing... Okay, that vision, for example, just now, I'll give you an example. Right? Our vision is to be a world-class organization. Being a world-class organization means we need to be able to deal with the crazy attention to details of the Europeans and the Japanese, for example. And we have to deal with a slightly laid-back Australian, but they also have clarity and very high expectations of what they wanted. And perhaps deal with the Middle Eastern that lacks all of this, but they also are demanding in a different manner. And then dealing with the Indians and dealing with the Indonesians and all that. So we need to have that world-class mindset. So changing that requires us to be able to make the right decisions all the time. So we actually come up with the philosophy, how do we do the right thing here, basically? You know, how do we make sure that we have enough resources at any time, because we were scaling, right? And at every step of the way, we were finding issues and challenges. How are we addressing those issues and challenges to enable us to continue to grow? So that's our philosophy, right? Doing things right, doing the right thing. And at the same time, We also have the third pillar, is that we are all shapeshifters. You know, especially in this era, I mean, this technology industry, it changes very fast. What works well in this year, it may not work already next year. And which, in other words, it means that our horizon must be further. We have to be thinking already, what's the in thing 2 years from now? What's the in thing 5 years from now? In fact, today, our boys are already developing something that will be the in thing 3 to 5 years from now. So there's a lot of crystal balling. There's a lot of crystal balling that's happening in the organization. All right, which is this, which is a simple thing, right? Today, in the drone industry, drones are already smart device. You know, you have drone. Drones by itself are stupid. It doesn't do anything. Right? Drone by itself is nothing. Right? It flies, but it became smarter because you put smart sensors on it. So that's how it is today. But drone of the futures are already aerial robots. Robots are different than your fridge, for example, right? Or your microwave. Those are all functional devices. You know, even drones are in that category because it do things that you ask it to do, right? But to me, the future is actually where these drones are smart aerial robots. We no longer control them. What's going to happen is that we just give it a mission objective and then we will do it. We just approve or disapprove or monitor from afar. And that is the equality that I was talking to you about. We no longer need to do the hard work, the labor kind of work. We make the decision.
Is there a danger in that though, Kamarul, when you give the autonomy to act of their own volition to previously inert objects like robots? Because they're getting smarter. They're getting smarter at a far greater pace than humans are getting smarter, right? And Stephen Hawking has talked about it. Elon Musk has talked about it. A lot of smart people have voiced their fear at a robot future. And drones can be easily militarized, right? There will be obvious military applications, if not already done by companies like, I can't remember, there's a lot of them in America and of course in China as well. Does that concern you? A future which runs away out of your control?
I wouldn't say it will run away of our control, right? These robots are our slaves. We are the master.
For now.
These robots should...
For now.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you've seen stuff like, what, you know, Boston Dynamics in America, some of the stuff they're producing is off the scale, right?
Absolutely.
If they can grow a brain like that.
You see the way I look at it is this way, right? People are always afraid of things that they don't understand, right? Even in this as well, right? I mean, it sounds scary. You're giving so much autonomy, you're giving so much decision-making and all that. But there are ways for us to manage this, right? I'm not saying that there's no risk. Obviously, there are risks, but we can put system in place. Even, for example, today, even if you look at the current day of flying drones, there are regulations in place that allow us to decide where we can fly, where we cannot fly, for example. You know, the permissions that we need to have in order to fly, right? Because at the end of the day, we are talking about how do we provide that impact to humanity. The real impact can happen only when these robots are workers that take care of us. And then that's where the industry is going. We are already developing drones that have AI on edge itself. AI, it can actually detect and make decisions. But the ultimate decision making is always us. We are the owner, except we do not have to be there. We will get notified. We will make that decision by ourselves, for example, right? So the whole idea about this, I know it sounds scary. The future sounds very, very scary, especially if I start sharing to you about technological singularity. Some people are saying the technological singularity is just 5 years away. Elon Musk says it's 5 years. Generally, people are saying this between 20 to 25 years. What's technological singularity? It's the time in the near future where the collective intelligence of machine,
yes,
will exceed the collective intelligence of human.
Yes.
And whether, yes, we like it or not, it's coming. You know, it's already coming.
Yes.
So right now, what we need to be doing and working on is that to make sure that we are masters of this technology. So that's actually what, to me, the approach that we need to be doing is that how do we harness this technology for our own good? The risk, like I said, we are totally on the same page. But to me, this is the next step of progress anyway. If we are not in this, then we are even at a greater mercy.
For parents and children who have been locked down for the last 15 months, right, the device and the addiction, the addictive capabilities of these devices is off the scale, right? I tell my children, don't let the game control you. You got to control the game. You got to design the game, build the game, be the programmer and the language behind the game. So for you, when you talk about being in charge of the robots, being in charge of the machines, right? For parents out there and for children or even teenagers or young adults who can have a glimpse into the future, because that's what the internet involved, they can see into the future. How can people prepare for the future where technology singularity is just 5 years away? And that is a scary time.
I think that's goes back to what I talked about earlier, right? It's about the readiness of our society here in Malaysia. That's one of our big why. You know, we need to be an educated and informed society. We need to be to have mastery over technology rather than a user of technology. And I'm also really glad that this is something that the government is also, you know, believe in this cause. That's why we are seeing a lot of things are being done right now as well in Malaysia. Of course, there's still room for improvement and all that. But at least in terms of being able to have mastery of this technology is something that is a clear focus. I mean, we are doing that ourselves right now. And of course, it is difficult. That's why even today, we are using resources in India. We are using resources in Indonesia, in the US and all that. The world is one today. Everything is interconnected. So we cannot just be good in our own country as well. So that's to me the assimilation of technology, the assimilations of talents must happen now. Otherwise, we get left behind. You know, if we don't catch up, I worry for the future generations. And that is actually one of our big cause here. I mean, our induction, every time a large group of people join, is actually about having this conversation. How can we play this role to make sure that we ourselves are ready for the future? How we ourselves can be the guys that create the future rather than participants, rather than just a user of future technology. So that is the drive.
I want to ask you about the Malaysian situation since you raised it up. And I think it's an apt conversation to have at this point in time, because for you to want to stay here, and I'm sure a lot of exchanges are looking for you to list in Hong Kong or Singapore or NASDAQ or even ASX, one of those places, right? Because I'm sure an IPO is on the cards for you as well, right? What's your thought process about those options? And how do you intellectualize what's happening in Malaysia right now?
Well, to me, Malaysia certainly do have a lot of potential, right? Even today, I mean, we are blessed that we can compare, right? Because we have global operations. We can see how the local talents' capability are and all that. To be honest with you, in terms of the technical capabilities, our guys are really at par, if not better in many aspects. What we do not have is the soft skill, the design thinking, the problem solving part. I mean, that's just the part that we are facing. But in terms of mathematics, in terms of science, we are really there. What we are really lacking as well is that the innovation part. I mean, we are good at the deep knowledge. We have the expert level knowledge and all that. But how do we build something meaningful out of that knowledge? How do we string together various different parts of knowledge in order to do something meaningful? And then that's the thing that I'm seeing, that it can be industry driven by people, I guess. Right? We can, because even right now, you know, we have so many gaps about talents that we needed. We cannot build ourselves in Malaysia, but we were able to actually find them locally. Then at the same time, we string all the dots together by getting talents from America, by using talents from India or talents from Japan, for example, right? So it's actually, we can almost be like the conductor that conduct a music of the future technology by bringing everything together and making a music out of it. You know? So okay. I'm happy that we are producing a lot of talents. You know, maybe half of them are ready for globalness, but maybe not 100% yet. But we do have that talent here in Malaysia, and even not just. In fact, I do not look at talents just from Malaysia's angle alone. I look at the whole Southeast Asia, for example. You know, we do hire from Indonesia. We just entered Thailand as well. We have access to talent in Thailand. You know, we are already using talent from Vietnam as well. So that's the way we philosophize this whole situation. I mean, we must look at ourselves as a global entity, as a global company, with a physical HQ in Malaysia.
Okay. So when you talk to investors and you raise money at whatever, Series B, Series C, and as you go through the process, what is the potential? Because $500 million is just the starting point, right? And then I think you've talked in the press about going for an IPO down the line, I think maybe 2022 or 2023, right? What is the big picture for you?
Yeah, I mean, we have a timeline, right? When our investors came in, the timeline is 5 years from our Series B for an exit for that, right? But of course,
2024.
That's our absolute deadline. Right? But it could be, we could go for an IPO earlier. It's really, you know, why do people go for IPO, right? I mean, it's to raise fund and also to have an exit for initial investors, right? For us, if you were to look at this requirement, the exit, we already have a finite deadline for our current investors to exit. But of course, this can be negotiated as well anyway. But the second part is about raising fund. So we do not really have a pick of an issue to raise fund for growth, for our expansions and all that. Because if people believe in you, people believe and understand what you are doing, and people see the potentials of what you're doing, people will want to come and invest in our potentials, right? So right now, we are not in a rush because raising fund is not really an issue for us at the moment, right? So that's how we look at it. We also are toying at the location where we would go for IPO in the future. Some of our existing investors are suggesting, hey, explore Japan, perhaps even explore Hong Kong. Some are saying explore NASDAQ, and that we already have an office in Washington, D.C. as well. I mean, so we are actually looking at probably our listing will be in one of these various markets.
Yeah, because the Southeast Asian story now is very, very strong. Grab is definitely looking at America. C Limited, which runs Shopee and Garena, they have a depository receipt in New York, but of course they're Singapore based. Kasem and Catcher, they raised their money on the NYSE. So but of course I think Bukalapak recently is listed, but they listed in Jakarta, which is interesting. And they are $6 billion, $7 billion now valuation. It would be quite tough for you to list in Bursa Malaysia, right? Because it's just too small.
Yeah. I think at the current situation it's I mean, the local market doesn't really understand technology the way those markets do, right? In fact our horizon is already there. I mean, our investors from Japan are already talking to us. Let's initiate our process for Japan. So we said, yeah, we like the idea, but we are also keeping the options open. We are exploring NASDAQ. You know, we are even exploring the idea of dual listing both in Japan and NASDAQ. But then again, I mean, we are talking about this, but it is something that is in our mind, but it's not the key focus at the moment. I mean, that's actually our destination. Our focus right now is really about growing the company, extending our reach, you know, developing the new verticals to the next level and all that.
Yeah, so as a person, right, Kamarul, you've been computer associates, you've worked Kasim Chan auditor, you've done the technology geek thing, you're not an entrepreneur, you're from Kelantan. I'm presuming you're around about the fifth decade of your life, 40 to 50 years old. You know, obviously you've seen a few things. What are your life principles? You know, in terms of working life, in terms of personal life, in terms of approach to money and, you know, the whole dollar sign thing. You know, what kind of advice can you give to the young people?
Let me talk about the philosophy first, then I'll talk about the young people. Okay, our philosophy is always about fairness. You know, it's about fairness and value creation. You know, we do not believe in exploitation. You know, for us, it has always have to be a win-win for both, or whatever engagement that we may have. It's always about mutual benefits. You know, even for aero rangers, that's what we call our staff here. Our arrangement between me and my aero rangers is all about fairness. It's all about uplifting their capabilities, about making them better in what they do, about bringing them to the next level as well. I mean, we have aero rangers from Malaysia all over the world now. We're giving them, creating them the opportunities to travel, to learn new things. And the way we deal with the market, with the industry, with our clients as well, is also always about fairness. Yeah, so the philosophy is one of fairness and equality to all. That translates in what we do on the daily lives as well, in our daily operations. That's how we handle things between the people here, between us and our partners globally as well. You know.
So those are business principles, right? What about life principles? How do you, for example, balance growing a business which takes almost all your time with your personal life, right? Maybe your spiritual life as well. How do you balance all those things in the air?
Well, to me, I combine my spirituality with what I do as well. I mean, you think about it, what is spirituality? It's all about bringing you to your creators. And what does it mean, bringing you too close to your creators, about understanding it? It's all also about humanity. It's about the same thing. So I do not really make a difference between my spirituality and my business philosophy. Personally, I'm a simple person. You know, what drives us, and my wife asks me all the time, why are we working so hard? Why are you working so hard? You know, and it's...
You're trying to conquer the world, man. That's why.
And it's not the money, really. It's not the money, you know. For us, that is a byproduct. You know, it's not even the objective. What we are doing is that the big why is the big cause. You know, our biggest satisfaction, just like a paternal pride. You know, you have kids of your own. For us as well, right? My kids are all grown up. We got married very early, by the way. So my kids are all grown up. My daughter just became an MO this week as well. You know, my son is working here as well. My eldest is already also a producer working on the project with DreamWorks. So that's paternal pride. I mean, you work hard, you build, you give education to the children, you give them the exposure so that they become someone useful to society. They become good soul, basically, right? So that's paternal pride. So the company is also, I would even look at it from that perspective, right? The pride to me in seeing the company grows, in seeing that we have good guys over here. They've gone through the process of filtration of you know, the those that are not compatible with us have left, and a new one that comes in, and to see the company grows, you know, every month there's hiring, you know, every year we grow to the next level. I mean, it's the pride of seeing this grow to the next level. And perhaps that's something that I can leave my legacy on. You know, I mean, and it's not just me. It's actually the people here as well. My teammates, my fellow footballer on the field. So, you know, we are in this together.
You know, one concept which a lot of people might not realize is the fact that a lot of entrepreneurs, they don't see money as being very important. You know, Elon Musk, right? Elon Musk doesn't care. He appears to not care about money. Let me just qualify that. He appears to not care about money, right? And I tend to believe that because he's a geek. He's a scientist. He just wants to do something new, right? I get that impression with you as well. I had that feeling. I could be wrong because we've never even met in person, you know. But there's a lot of people who want to do something crazy, but actually money is not that important. How does it work for you?
Absolutely right. I mean, in my earlier days, it was an objective, but not anymore. You know, we don't really care about money. To us right now, it's all about, we have this concept here called Masoon, M-S-O-O-N, making something out of nothing. So it's all about that innovation culture. It's about creating things. And when we create these new things, this new thing is something that impact humanity, that have a lot of, that touches people's life, that change the way they live, you know, allow them to do things better. I let me share with you something. Between me and my wife, we talk about this all the time, you know. Our paternal pride goes even to our fellow aero rangers. You know, when we hire someone, join us, fresh grads, you can tell, you know, that perhaps they come from less privileged family. Within 2 years, they can buy a house, they can buy a new car, you know. So we feel proud to see that transformation in our people as well. You know, I have people, fresh grad, that join us. Let's talk about money, like, simple metrics that people can understand. So people have joined us, perhaps fresh grad, salary was 3,005. After a couple of years, some of them are 10,000, 15,000 kind of salary, because those that can perform, you know, the paternal pride that we have, that's the drive and satisfaction that we have, that we can, you know, see that people can grow in the organization to us, and seeing their ability to create new things, that Masoon that I mentioned, creating solutions to this overall technology that we are creating. People are contributing to each of these technology puzzles, because all of these are interrelated. So seeing that our team that we nurture from small, from beginning, from not knowing much, to being able to create this, I mean, that is, you know, to me, the ultimate satisfaction, basically.
Fantastic, man. So your approach to money is just as a means to an end, right? Otherwise, it's just, you know, what really drives you is this, is the company, is the people development, and just trying to change the world. I guess that's the message you're trying to send.
Yeah, but of course we have to make money for our investors as well. Right? I mean, that's of course still important. Is the triple P, like, people, planet, and profit. Profit is still important as well, right? We need to make our stakeholders happy, but the people and planet is something that is very close to us as well. We talk a little bit about people as well. Planet is something that is very close to us. You know, if we look at MIT, there's a MIT studies. I don't know whether I talked about this already, but they are already talking about civilization decline, not too far away, right? So this is something that we all have to play a role here. That civilization decline could happen as early as 2030 because of over exploitation, right? So this is something.
Oh, definitely.
I think there's a lot of studies which show that peak population has occurred, and that birth rates the last 2 years have declined precipitously across the developed world. Don't talk about emerging markets, of course, like Bangladesh and Nigeria and places like India. And some people might also say that the environment has passed the point of no return. I think the latest studies have indicated that as well. There's forest fires, there's huge droughts in parts of northwestern America. And of course, extreme cold just 6 months ago. Do you think we're past the point of no return? I mean, not that we are geologists here, or, you know, but just in terms of where we feel the world is.
I feel that we are at a critical time, not just for environment. This COVID, I think we are just at the beginning stage. I think we are in this for a long haul. You know, this is already changing the way we look at things, changing at the philosophy. I mean, this Delta variant, this is just the beginning, you know. The Lambda is already out. I mean, we might finish all the alphabet, basically, right? So it's scary. I mean, we have to be rethinking a lot of things, you know. And I think humanity as a whole will not allow this to, you know, to disrupt us or end us, like, basically, right? So even though it has happened before in the past, one of my fascination is in history. Something like this has happened before many, many times. So that cycle has already happened. But I think that we can do something about this. And together, a lot of people are already doing this as well anyway.
Well, since you're a student of history, and of course, since the days of the Egyptian scrolls, they have drawn, and of course hieroglyphs as well, they've drawn unidentified flying objects since those days, and they remain unexplained. Just a few months ago, the Pentagon confirmed the fact that they saw the existence, and they've basically confirmed the existence of UFOs and UFAs. As a geek yourself, right? I'm sure you read about that. What do you make of it?
Obviously, I mean, this is a large part of my life. I mean, it has transformed me as well, right? Because to me, I'm a firm believer that there's a lot of past history that we are not aware of. And I've been unraveling this past history myself. And that cycle has been happening, you know, like nuclear explosion. We first explode in a nuclear device in recent times, only in the 1940s. But when you ask Oppenheimer at that time, this is only the first time in modern times. It has happened before as well, right? So you go to India, you will see, archaeological sites with a very clear nuclear explosion proof. a proof of explosion happening in that region. It's all over the world. So when you talk about flying unidentified UFOs and all that, it's there. The universe is so big. We can't say for sure we are the only one here. You know, it's a big place. You know, we are just a speck in the sky.
So with technology singularity coming, with the fact that UFOs are confirmed, with the fact that there's a lot of stuff we don't know, and the world is changing very, very fast, we could be facing a very, very different future, right? What is the one life lesson that you would leave people to perhaps guide their existence into the future?
Clarity of vision. We must stay true to ourselves, what we wanted to achieve, just like in any entrepreneurial journey as well. You must be relentless. You know, solving problem is part of the process. You know, the differentiator between you and your peers that have been sidelined is actually because they give up. So I think what I would say is that never give up. You know, just keep going. Times will get hard, especially those in this who's crazy enough to be an entrepreneur. You know, you must keep going. I mean, I went through, as I said, in our last 7 years, we have went through 9 showstoppers. Otherwise, would have been a showstopper, but we have been solving them one after, and I'm sure there will be more in the future as well.
Okay, man. Kamarul Muhamed, you are a revelation, man, and you are fascinating to talk to. Thank you for your time, Aerodyne. I wish you the best of luck, and I hope you really pop when you IPO in 2 or 3 years' time. Thank you for talking to me.
Thank you. All right.